What's up, nerds? Welcome back. I am Nate in the Wild. I'm here in beautiful Grand Teton National Park with such an exciting announcement. The all-new Sony 12-24 f2.8 G Master. This thing is beautiful, highly anticipated. I'm gonna cruise around for the next couple days, try and get some shots with it, and then let's pop that card into the computer, see how it looks, see if it lives up to that G Master name. Let's go. So let's start with some of the technical stuff here, because I think people's first fear when they hear about a lens like this is that it's going to be an absolute monster. But realistically, it's actually pretty reasonable for being a 12-24 f/2.8. It's only 96mm by 137mm and weighs 847 grams. So with that said, it's more or less the exact same size as Sony's 24-70 f/2.8. It's actually 39 grams lighter, in fact. So all in all, pretty portable, especially considering the focal range and the aperture that you get in this package. It's also worth noting that this is the first ever 12-24 f/2.8 on the market. Nikon makes a 14-24 mm f/2.8 that's 153 grams heavier than this and lacks that extra 2 mm of focal length on the short end. And Canon actually has an 11-24, which sounds nice, but it's only an f/4 lens and it is 233 grams heavier. So not only does this have the widest aperture, the widest focal length, but it's also the lightest lens in its category. Honestly, it's truly kind of a revolutionary thing, and I'm pretty excited that they have finally turned their crazy Sony engineers loose on the lens side of things, because they've been dominating the sensor game for a long time, it seems like. Now, as far as design goes, this looks very similar to the rest of the G Master lenses. You have a manual focal length selector for zooming here. You have a manual focus ring with an autofocus manual focus switch and a programmable focal hold button, which is all very nice. Something that I find kind of interesting is that it is internal zoom, meaning that when you turn this zoom ring, the lens itself doesn't actually get any longer, but you can see this front bulbous element does move in and out. It's kind of nice for weather sealing that it doesn't extend like the 24-70 and the 16-35 do, but it's not, I guess, a true internal zoom. I think it's kind of cool. It doesn't really, there's no negative to this. It's just kind of something worth noting. The pedal hood is actually integrated into the lens, meaning you can't take it off to make the lens more portable and compact, but it does provide guaranteed protection against dings and scrapes, because if you're anything like me, that's almost a certainty with a front element like this. I do like the upgraded lens cap design. The original 12-24 f/4 that Sony came out with had a lens cap that only goes on in one specific way, and it's kind of a bummer in the dark or if you're moving quickly and you can't quite get it on there. This one will attach in several different orientations. Just a slight redesign of that is all it took, and I love that. So of course, with a big front element and a built-in hood like this lens has, you're not going to be using screw-on front filters. So Sony gave it a rear-mounted slide-in filter slot, so you can actually mount your ND filters right in front of the image sensor itself. I didn't get a chance to test this because I didn't know this was going to be part of the lens until I'd already received it, but it seems like a pretty innovative solution and it should work out pretty well. Now, the optical performance of this lens is just revolutionary, to be completely honest. It has three extreme aspherical elements, which is part of what allowed them to get 12mm at f/2.8 with no distortion. This thing is rectilinear, and it's because of those extreme aspherical elements. There are also three extra low dispersion glass elements for reduced flare and ghosting, but there's also two super extra low dispersion glass elements to even further increase transmissivity and reduce any sort of weird optical performance that you might have shooting into the sun. I'm not sure I fully understand the difference between the extra low dispersion and super extra low dispersion, but word on the street is that this is a pretty fancy integration that hasn't been seen in one of Sony's lenses before. Another thing that's brand new in this lens is the XD linear focus motors. These are the same linear focus motors that you find in the 400mm f/2.8 and the 600mm f/4, which are, you know, $12,000, $13,000 wildlife telephoto prime lenses. So putting that focus motor in this lens is already cool, but the coolest thing is there's four of them, which gives you hyper-accurate, hyper-fast focusing, and it will be absolutely silent for those video junkies out there. So I'm sure there's gonna be 1,000 articles written with technical information, so without diving too far into that, let's look at some sample photos, because I think that's probably why everyone's already here anyways, right? I hiked out last week about 8 miles into bear country with a headlamp to take some photos for you at this beautiful reflecting lake. And I shot a photo at 24 millimeters here. It's nothing fancy, I just wanted to see how bad the vignette was. And the answer is, it's pretty reasonable. Stopping down to f4, you can see there's a little bit of a reduction in the vignette. It already looks really even corner to corner. And by f5.6, it's completely gone. I did stop all the way down to f22 just to see, and as expected, the lens is not very sharp at f22, but hopefully none of you are shooting at f22 to begin with, so that shouldn't be a huge issue. Now at 12 millimeters, there is a vignette, which is to be expected, of course, but it's much more minor than I was expecting. Honestly, the vignette on this lens at 12 millimeters f2.8 is less than, say, the Voigtlander 21 millimeter f1.4, which is kind of incredible because you're at 12 millimeters. Now, at the time of recording this, basically nobody knows this lens exists yet because I'm one of the pre-testers, so there's no Lightroom built-in lens profile for me to do correction. So I used the profile for the old 12 to 24 millimeter, and that actually did a fantastic job, and we're left with basically no vignetting on this photo. If you don't like to use the Lightroom lens corrections, I did stop it down to f4 and f5.6, and you can see a bit of a dramatic reduction in this vignette, but it looks pretty good across all of those apertures. And as I've mentioned in some of my other videos, a vignette isn't necessarily a bad thing. It's kind of an artistic choice. I just don't like it to be forced upon me. So this is a minor vignette. It's easy to correct, and if you like it, which I do, I think it looks really nice. So I know you all were hoping that I would stay out there till it got dark and shoot some astro photos. Obviously I did, because I'm a sucker for a good astro photo, and 12 millimeters at f2.8 is pretty seductive for those of us who like the nighttime photography. So I shot this at 24 millimeters, which is a great focal length for astrophotography to begin with, but I also wanted to see how this lens performed at all of the extremes, not just 12 millimeters, but at 24 as well. So zooming in, you can see that it's very sharp. It does a great job. There's a little bit of long exposure and high ISO noise, but that's nothing to be concerned with. It's not the lens's fault. But something that's worth noting, because this is a rectilinear lens, the tree trunks at the edges of the frame are still straight. You don't have any of that weird fisheye barrel distortion. At 24 millimeters, I wasn't really expecting that, and we'll look again at 12 millimeters, but that's a great start. Now you can see just a little bit of spherical aberration around some of the brighter stars, but I don't see any chromatic aberration really, maybe a tiny bit of magenta around this bright one up there. And then moving into the corners, everything looks pretty good. There's a little bit of a stretch, but again, you know, 24 millimeters is pretty wide. Honestly, it looks, in my mind, as good as the 24 millimeter f1.4 G Master does at this focal length. So moving on to the shot at 12 millimeters, obviously you can see this is a fantastic focal length for astrophotography, really opens up the scene. Zooming in here on the center of the frame, you can see still fantastically sharp. At 12 millimeters, to zoom in this far and still have that kind of detail, really, really impressive to me. The stars all still look good. They're tiny little pinpoints. I do have to be honest, I found it pretty difficult to focus at 12 millimeters. I'm not sure if that's really the lens necessarily or just a function of trying to focus a lens on a tiny star at 12 millimeters. That's gonna be difficult no matter what you do. But once I got it dialed in, I got a little more used to the lens and what I was doing, it focused in pretty easily. And you can see these stars are single pixels in diameter. They're very, very nicely focused. Again, the rectilinear feature on this, these tree trunks are still super straight. They are leaning a bit towards the center of the frame, so maybe this is like 98% rectilinear, but at 12 millimeters, this could be an insane fisheye and everything would look like a circle, so I consider this pretty incredible. Now, if we look up into the corners of the frame, we do get some pretty serious pixel stretching, and this is where the rectilinear design is gonna kind of catch up with us. At 12 millimeters, these stars look like they're sort of zooming out of the corners. It's sort of an artistic thing. I had that old Rokinon 14 millimeter lens, and it had this the worst of anything I've ever seen. Like every photo looked like it was just to the corners, and I liked it. I sold magazine covers with that lens. So this is pretty minor in my opinion. It definitely exists. If you're looking for a, you know, flawless image that's both rectilinear and has no pixel stretching, that doesn't exist. And I think this is an incredible balance of those two options. So while I was out at this barn, I pointed it directly into the sun because I wanted to see how true to life these claims were about the nano AR coating and the ED glass reducing these flares. You can see at F9, there's an incredible sun star. It's beautiful. That's due to the 9-blade circular aperture iris there. But there actually is very little lens flare. You can see there's a little bit of kind of a rainbow, couple dots moving down the screen, but those are very small. I opened it back up to F2.8 to see if wide open things looked a little bit different. You can see that the sun's star turns into more of a glowing disc, which is pretty reasonable. That's pretty common for most lenses. And the lens flare, there's less of those little dots, and now it's kind of just more of a small smudge. But this is significantly less than most lenses have. And I have to admit, it does seem as though those claims are true. The other photos I want to go through here are just kind of talking about how to use this lens, because I think the technique of when to implement it is as exciting as the actual technical specifications and the sharpness, etc. Having a lens that can shoot 12mm astro, but then come back and shoot a daytime landscape shot like this one, I think is really, really cool. This is shot at 24mm. It's kind of a fun storm moving in right near sunset over the Grand Teton here, and it looks dramatic as all heck, but of course, if we zoom out at 12mm, suddenly this goes from being pretty dramatic to like one of the most dramatic photos I've ever seen in my life. You can see that it stretches things to the corners. This is where that rectilinear design actually brings more drama into the photo. It pulls these clouds to the corner and it makes it look like the storm is moving. I mean, the storm was moving, but I really like that extra drama by having that 12mm field of view. Same thing with this barn. It's kind of a classic, dare I say, boring shot of a barn. But at 12mm, you get that dramatic wide angle shot. This barn has been shot maybe more than any other building in the history of the United States. But I found that at 12mm with a drama storm moving overhead, I was able to take a photo that I think is actually pretty unique to me. And I love that. Now, another thing that I think is really cool potential with this lens is not necessarily portraiture, because portraits at 12mm are kind of tough, but things like action sports. So I went out on what I consider to be maybe the most grueling hike I've ever done with my friend Pete Stone. He took me up into the Tetons and we did some rock climbing. You can see here at 24mm, this looks like, you know, a standard rock climbing photo like you might see in a magazine. But at 12mm, all of a sudden we get some sense of scale here, and you can see that he's not just on a cliff. He is in this massive alpine amphitheater, and I always love shooting wide on expeditions when I'm climbing mountains, and this lens more than any other gives me that opportunity. I climbed the tallest mountain in Peru last year, and I carried my full frame camera setup, and the 16-35 G Master was my go-to lens for the entire climb. If this lens had existed, it would have been in my bag instead. But again, this lens isn't great for portraits, but if you look at Kaylee here cleaning a cam out of her lead route, Mount Tiwanaut in the background wouldn't have been visible at 24mm, but shooting it here at 12, you can fit the cam in out of focus in the foreground and the entire amphitheater she just climbed in the background, and it gives this incredible drama. It sets the tone, it sets the location. I wouldn't want to shoot this image any other way. I also love it for things like wildflowers, because you can shoot wide enough to show the whole field plus the settings. I love it for shooting just calm reflections with a storm that's clearing out. If you're clever about it, you can even use this lens for wildlife. Although, you know, it has to be a pretty specific use case, but 12mm for wildlife is a pretty hilarious opportunity as well. I think the 12mm is really the benefit here. Of course, it's beautiful at all focal lengths in between, but I really can't recommend this enough for anyone who considers themselves an outdoor photographer. It's probably great for cities and stuff too, but that's not my forte, I can't really speak to it. But for things like landscapes, nature, adventure, specifically backpacking, hiking photos, 12mm is really gonna make those adventures look larger than life. I can't recommend it enough. Thank you all so much for watching. My name is Nate in the Wild again. Let me know if you have any questions down in the comments. I'll be answering as many of them as I can. And thank you so much. Please click like, click subscribe, tell all your friends, and send a postcard to your grandma. Hopefully she's doing well. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.